Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Okay, moving on, regarding the first point, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى وَاحِدْ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one without any partners. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one. إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَاحِدْ. Several Quranic verses that indicate to this. وَإِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ لا إله إلا هو الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد. Mushrikeen in Mecca asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, describe your Lord to us. This verse was revealed. قل هو الله أحد. الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. Say Allah is one. He has no partners. واحد and أحد. واحد and أحد. Imam Tahawi rahmatullahi alayhi has used the word واحد. واحد means one. أحد also means one. Some scholars have differentiated between these two words. The واحد for attributes, the واحد في الصفات and أحد في الذات. But they can also be used in each of the places. So Wahid is for sifat, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one inside His attributes, and Ahad, He is one inside His being. So Allah is one inside His being, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is also one inside His attributes. Meaning there is no entity like the entity of Allah. And there's nobody who possesses the qualities and the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now there's a discussion here regarding the difference between ilah and rabb. Rabb and ilah. The word rabb came before this in the opening text. But I'm mentioning it now because we can compare and contrast now between ilah and rabb. The word rabb came in the opening text where Imam Tahawi rahmatullahi alayhi said, وَيَدِينُونَ بِهِ رَبَّ الْعَالَمِينَ. That there implemented or they have acquired the deen. Which deen? The deen of Rabb al-Alameen, the Rabb of the entire, all of the universes, all of the worlds. And now we have the word here is Inna Allah. Allah is from Ilah. We say in Salah, Alhamdulillahi رب العالمين. The all praise to Allah, who is the Rabb, who is the sustainer of all of the universes. So down here, I want to briefly discuss the concept that some people have. They differentiate and they have made types of Tawhid. Now, having types of Tawheed is probably not a problem. Yeah, it may not be a problem. However, the meaning that it carries behind, or the meaning that these people advocate behind these taqseem and these terminologies, that is problematic. Right. And this, again, I told you, it starts. This started off with from Hafiz bin Taymiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi, and then later on, the sharh that I showed you last week that I have here of Ibn Izz al-Hanafi, the supposed Hanafi, where he basically advocated the opinion of Hafiz ibn Taymiyyah, and those that have come after, the contemporary scholars and those that are recent, Sheikh bin Baz and Sheikh Albani and Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen and Sheikh Fawzan, and these Salafi Saudi scholars. If you look inside the commentaries, if you look in the ta'liqat, the commentary of Ibn Baz, and if you look at Ibn Izz al-Hanafi's sharh, etc., you will see that they have categorized the tawheed into three types. Right? So they have the tawheed al-rububiyyah, tawheed al-rububiyyah, tawheed al-uluhiyyah. So the oneness inside the rububiyyat of Allah, the oneness inside the uluhiyat. And then Tawhīd, Tawhīdul Asma wa Sifat. Tawhīdul Asma wa Sifat. Tawhīd inside the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, first and foremost, yes. Uluhiyya. So what does these words mean? We need to obviously first know what are the words and what it means and what meanings it has and which meaning is correct and which meaning is incorrect. Now the word Tawheed, Rububiyya. So oneness of Allah is to believe in oneness. Now say no, you have to believe in the oneness of Allah to be a Rabb is separate. To believe in the oneness of Allah to be Ilah is a separate Tawheed. And to believe in the oneness of the names and attributes is a separate. Now what does Rabb Ilah mean? We can go into that inshallah discussion. But what they're doing, they've made these into three categories. And they've said that the Mushrikeen Makkah, they believed in the Rububiyyah of Allah. They believed in the Rububiyyah. Meaning they believed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be the creator. Because according to them, those people, the Salafis, scholars, they have categorized the types of Tawheed. According to them, Rabb, in a nutshell, means the creator, the Khaliq. Yeah? So they say even the Mushrikeen in Makkah, they believed in this, that Allah is Khaliq, Razik, etc. Tawheed Rububiyyah. And the Quranic verse they give is, وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهِ. That if you ask the Mushrikeen in Makkah, who created the heavens and the earth, they will say, Allah. So they said they had Tawheed Rububiyyah. So Abu Jahl and the company, they had Tawheed Rububiyyah. They had Iman in this type of Tawheed. What they were lacking in, and because why they became mushrik, was Tawheed Uluhiyya. Tawheed Uluhiyya means having one, worshipping Allah subhanahu alone. To believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be ilah, and He is the only ma'bud bihaqqin, as they say, they lacked in this. So to believe that Allah to be a creator, the Razik, that's okay, but to worship Him only, this is what the Mushrikeen in Makkah lacked. And Tawheed al-Asma wa Sifat basically means to believe in Allah's, the oneness of Allah's names and attributes. But what they really intend by this, which I'm not going to mention here, probably another, I need a full course just dedicated on this topic, is where it comes the Sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the names and attributes, and they take the literal meaning. They say Allah's got a hand, literal hand. Allah's literally sitting on the throne. Allah literally descends to the heavens. That's what they say. Oh, we need to have the proper Tawheed inside the names and attributes. Meaning, take the names literally, in other words. Right, okay. Now, first we need to understand the meaning of Rabb and Ilah. First we need to understand the meaning of Rabb and Ilah. Then, from once we understand the meaning of Rabb and Ilah, we will be able to determine whether the word Rabb and Ilah are two different meanings or they both mean the same, the lazim manzoom. Meaning that wherever there is a Rabb, if a person believes in Rabb, he believes in Ilah. If he believes in Ilah, he believes in intrinsic, lazim manzoom, as they say. Yeah? They say the light, for example, what does the word lazim mean? Obligatory, imperative, compulsory. For example, the light for the sun is, the sunlight for the sun is lazim. The wetness and the flow for the water is, the sweetness for the honey is lazim. It's lazim, it has to be there. So if Rabb is there, then the word ilah has to be there. The meaning of ilah has to be there. If the meaning of ilah is there, then the meaning of Rabb has to be there. So once we know the meaning of Rabb and ilah, then we'll be able to determine the difference between Rabb and Ilah, then we'll be able to determine the next step, whether the Mushrikeen in Makkah actually believed in Rububiyyat, as they say. Or did they do shirk in that also? Because it all depends on the definition and meaning. So let's start off with the word Rabb. The word Rabb, you pick up the Quran, you say, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. The translation will be, all praise to Allah, who is the sustainer of all the words. Now it's sustained, the word is Rabb, English translation, yeah? And the reality is that the English language in itself doesn't do justice to the meanings of the word, for the Arabic words. That's why we need to obviously look at the Arabic dictionaries, etc. And looking at other Quranic verses to understand the word Rabb in its true sense. Now what does the word Rabb mean? Allahu Akbar. Iman gets taza. You know what I'm saying? And this is the Tablighi Jamaat through one of the attacks on the Tablighi Jamaat is by you give Tawhid of Rububiyyat, you never give Dawat of Tawhid, Uluhiyat. You tell people that Allah Khalik hai, Malik hai, Razik hai, we hear Allah all the time, but Tawhid Uluhiyat, the proper Tawhid. You don't give Dawat to people towards this. So inshallah, all these questions and misconceptions inshallah will be answered and understood inshallah once we have analyzed the definition of these words and then the evidence in the Quran. The word Rabb, what does Rabb mean? Imam Baydawi rahmatullahi alayhi, inside his tafsir, he's defined Rabb as following, تَبْلِيغُ الشَّيْءِ إِلَىٰ كَمَالِهِ شَيْئًا فَشَيْئًا. تَبْلِيغُ الشَّيْءِ إِلَىٰ كَمَالِهِ شَيْئًا فَشَيْئًا. Imam Baydawi. Imam Baydawi. Yeah. Now, I just humble request. If you can write fast, is good. Yeah. If you can't write, no problem. Even if you understand it, and afterwards try to just jot a few notes down, it'll be better. Because inshallah, it's on live on my page. It's all recorded, inshallah. So one of the friend's students is also going to put it onto YouTube. I didn't even know about the first three lectures of the first course is already on YouTube. Somebody put it up, mashallah, reward there. Yeah, it was actually my friend Osama, he put it up, mashallah. So he probably do the same with this. So, yeah, because you don't want to miss out the point. Try to understand first. Afterwards, inshallah, if you give 5-10 minute break, you can just jot down a few notes, important ones. Afterwards, you can obviously expand on that. It'll be better. Imam Malik rahmatullahi alayhi was the opinion of this too, and Ustaz Allama Dr. Khalid Mahmood, he always says this, okay. Likho afterwards, but at the time try to listen, because you'll probably miss a point writing Imam Baydawi, but the point I mentioned after that, you'll miss that, which is more important than Imam Baydawi. So tablighu shay ila kamalihi shay'an fa shay'an, Imam Baydawi mentioned the Rabb is that being that makes everything reach its destination slowly and gradually. And that being that makes everything reach its destination in the best of form and manner gradually. Now it's a tarbiyat. They say in Urdu, tarbiyat, upbringing. Tarbiyat, upbringing. So that's one meaning of Rabb, tarbiyah. That you make sure everything is looked after, it reaches its destination, is kamal, its completion, in the best way and form, slowly and gradually. Who can do this? Only Allah. The Rabb, the tarbiyah of a father for the son is metaphorical, is limited. It's only to his son and at a certain age. A time comes and he doesn't listen to the father too. This tarbiyah, we're talking about tarbiyah haqiqi. And not just tarbiyah of child, tarbiyah of the entire universe, Rabbil Alameen. Right? Another meaning, which Imam Tabarani, rahmatullahi alayhi, has mentioned inside his tafsir. And tafsir al-Tabari is the only tafsir, fi ma'alam, in my knowledge, in my very limited knowledge, that every tafsir has a chain of transmission, sanad. He has a chain of transmission and then he narrates tafsir. The other tafsir, tafsir ibn Kathir, tafsir Imam Razi, Qurtubi, etc. They don't have this as Imam Tabari has. Now if you look inside the meaning of Rabb that has been given by Imam Tabari in his tafsir, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alam, you will understand that three things regarding the word Rabb. Murabbi, Rabb. Number one, he's a Sayyid al-Muta'. He's a master who is obeyed. This is, I'm talking about I'm not going to give you the full all the entire definition. I'm taking the main 3 points that consist in the definition of Rabb. Number one, a Sayyid al-Muta'. The master which is obeyed. Number two, al-Muslih. The one that rectifies and fixes things. And number three, al-malik lishay, the one that owns something, who has ownership over something. Now, if we look at the word malik here, milk. So the word rab down here is not just that he brings, looks after, he actually is obeyed, he actually fixes the things, and he, the things that he's looking after, he also owns it. He also, because we're not talking about the Malik Khan that walks around in the streets, the milki idafi, which is a metaphorical ownership. You know, people that we own here is very, it's limited. If I own a car, the ownership is limited. If I own a house, the milkiyat is limited. A person, he can't own everything forever. It's all limited. But Malik Hakiki, so what's the difference between a Malik Hakiki and Malik Majazi? An actual owner and a metaphorical owner. Actual owner is that he actually owns the commodity, the being in itself. Yeah? Whereas a Malik Majazi, or should I say Milki Idafi, is someone who doesn't own the actual thing, but he owns the benefits that are derived from the thing. He owns the benefits that are derived from the thing. So when we're talking about milk here and ownership and his attribute towards Allah, we are talking about complete ownership of the thing, of the entity in itself. That's why, if you look in the Quran, what does it say? Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praise to Allah, who is the Rabb of all of the universes. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. He's most merciful, most kind. Malik Yawmiddin. He's the Malik of the day of Qiyamah. He can only be Malik if he's Rabb. That's why he says Malik down here. That Allah is Malik. Why? Because he's Rabb. He's Rabb, so he's Malik. Because the word Rabb also includes the meaning of Milkiyat Malik. Right? Now, so if you look at the word Rabb, right, the word Rabb, it is a very, very holistic word, very comprehensive word, and includes, if you want to put this into a nutshell, the word Rabb. Rabb is that being, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that being that has complete authority, without any conditions or restrictions in administrating and controlling the affairs of the world. This will be like, if you look at the definition of Imam Baydawi and Imam Tabarani, etc. This is like one comprehensive definition, that the word Rabb means one that has complete authority. Tasarruf mutlaq. And Allah, you know, I have a watch. I have the sort of, I can do what I want, I can sell it, I can throw it away, I can gift it to somebody. Yes. So Allah, like this, He has complete tasarruf, without any conditions, without any restrictions, in what? In tajbir, in controlling and in administration of the affairs of the universe and the world, the creation in general. Right? Now, so you understand the word Rabb. Yeah, it's got a very general meaning. It's not just the way Salafi scholars say that Allah is Khalik. Right? Now, if you look at the Quran, one verse, and this inshallah will prove this, will open this meaning more, is Surah Zumar, verse 3. If you open Surah Zumar, verse 3, أَلَا لِلَّهِ الدِّينُ الْخَالِصِ. ألا لله الدين الخالص والذين اتخذوا من دونه أولياء ما نعبدهم إلا ليقربونا إلى الله زلفى إن الله يحكم بينهم فيما هم فيه يختلفون إن الله لا يهدي من هو كاذب كفار. This is regarding the mushrikeen in Mecca. Now we need to slowly analyze. What did I say in the beginning? The Salafi scholars and the Salafis of today, they claim that the mushrikeen in Mecca, they had Tawhid Rububiyyah. They had Tawhid Rububiyyah. What did they do shirk in? Tawhid? You remember me saying, yeah? They believe Allah to be a Rabb, but Uluhiyah. And their sort of definition of Rabb was Allah's Khaliq and Razik. But I've told you that Rabb is not just this. Rabb has a very comprehensive meaning. So if you look at this verse, it says, Allah, behold, listen very carefully. Lillahi dinul khalis. Deen, and it is exclusively for Allah. Deen. Yeah? وَالَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ. Those people who take others as partners. Yeah? Other than Allah. Other than false gods. Apart from Allah, they worship. Why they say, مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَا إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. They say, we worship them only so that they may draw us close to Allah. They may draw us close to Allah. And then Allah said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَحْكُمُ بَيْنَهُمْ فِي مَا هُمْ فِي يَخْتَلِفُونَ. Verily Allah shall decide between them concerning the matters about which they differ. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي مَنْ هُوَ كَاذِبٌ كَفَّارٌ. Undoubtedly Allah does not guide the one who is a liar and a disbeliever. Now, there's two things in here. What did the mushrikeen in Mecca say? They say, we worship this idol, we only worship this idol so that it gets close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they're worshipping for the idols established. They worship for the idols established. Yeah? They said, we don't worship them except for this reason. Right? We don't worship them except for this reason. So there's two things established from this verse. Number one, that they worship apart from Allah. Yes, Professor? They worship apart from? The Quran is clear. مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا. We don't worship except for this reason. So meaning they did worship, even though it was a specific reason according to them, but they did worship other than Allah. Number two, they attributed a quality to other than Allah, which is exclusive to Allah only. What do I say this? I say this because what did they say? That we do this so they can draw us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, if I told you, you know, the word Rabb, one of the essence of the word Rabb is that to have complete authority over the administrations, over the affairs of the world. So down here, what they've said, drawing close to Allah, taqrib ila Allah. Taqrib ila Allah, to grow, to make people close to Allah, to make him a pious person, to make him that a pious person. This in itself is whose quality? Taqrib is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's quality. Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's quality. Yes? So what did they do? They shirk in that. So what have they actually done here too? They've not just done shirk in uluhiyyah, they've all done shirk in rububiyyah. They've also done shirk in rububiyyah. Why? Because part of the rububiyyah meaning, rububiyyah has, you know, is very comprehensive meaning. To believe Allah is the owner of everything, to believe Allah has control, complete authority in the administration of the affairs of the universe, to legislate. Legislation is also part of rububiyyah. To legislate what's halal and what's right and what's wrong. This is also part of rububiyyah. You have complete authority in their legislation. Or if you have complete authority or something, It's up to you whether you want to make it right or wrong, because you've got complete authority. So similarly, the word Rabb has all these meanings. So when they said that we only worship them so they can draw us close to Allah, so we can be accepted in the sight of Allah, what have they done? Number one, they clearly worship other than Allah. And number two, down here, they've attributed the haq, the right of the sarruf, meaning the authority of who will be close to Allah, who will be pious, who will be not pious. They've attributed this towards the idols, because this complete this tasarruf, this authority of making a person pious and a person fasiq and a sinner, this is only belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He gives guidance to whoever he wish. He is up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who he wants to draw close and who he wants to make distant. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is from the quality of Rabb. So down here, when they did shirk, it's not that just a shirk in uluhiyat. Yes, shirk in uluhiyat, yes. But at the same time, this is shirk in uluhiyat, is also shirk in rububiyat. Does that make sense? Yeah. That's why even let's look at this verse again. Inside this verse, ألا لله دين الخالص والذين اتخذوا من دون أولياء ما نعبدهم إلا ليقربون إلى الله زلفى. There's two main claims here. Number one, there's an iqrar and there's an iddia. There's a testimony, yeah, and there's also a claim. They're doing iqrar, meaning they are acknowledging, there's acknowledgement and there's a claim. What's the acknowledgement inside here? The acknowledgement inside here is that the false idols, they also have the power. The false idols also have the power to draw people close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they have some sort of tasarruf, they have some authority inside the administration of some of the affairs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the iqrar and acknowledgement from them. What is the claim? Their claim is that they don't worship them except for this reason. They don't worship them except for this reason. So the acknowledgement and claim. What's the acknowledgement? They acknowledge that these idols, they have some sort of authority in bringing people close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the only exclusive to the word Rabb, right? And at the same time, they are claiming that they're only worshipping this because to draw close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so they can draw them close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has refuted the acknowledgement and the claim. Inna Allaha yahkumu baynahum fima hum fihi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will decide in what they're disputing. This is refutation of the iqrar, the acknowledgement. Okay? And that they claim that they're only worshipping them for this reason, Allah has refuted this by saying, Inna Allaha la yahdi man huwa kadhibun kaffar. The person who's a liar, yeah, and who's a disbeliever, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not give guidance. So from this verse, it's quite clear that the mushrikeen in Makkah, what did they do? They didn't do the shirk in uluhiyyah, they actually did shirk in rububiyyah. How did they do shirk in rububiyyah? Because amongst the rububiyyah meaning is to have at-tasarruf al-mutlaq fi tadbir shu'un al-makhluqat, as the scholars have said, to have complete authority in controlling and in administrating the affairs of the creation. So when they said that they worship the idols, why? So it can draw them close to Allah. Now drawing close to Allah and making people distant from Allah, this is only in Allah's hands. It's only Allah's control. So down here they've done shirk in this part of the rububiyyat. Yeah? So they were not just mushrik because of uluhiyyat, it's because of rububiyyat also. Or if you look at also in the Quran, this is a very famous verse, a lot of people use this. قُلْ يَا أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ Surah Ali Imran, verse 64. قُلْ يَا أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ تَعَالَوْا إِلَىٰ كَلِمَةٍ سَوَاءٍ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ أَلَّا نَعْبُدَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَلَا نُشْرِكَ بِهِ شَيْئًا وَلَا يَتَّخِذَ بَعْضُنَا بَعْضًا أَرْبَابًا مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ فَإِنْ تَوَلَّوْا فَقُولْ أَشْهَدُ بِأَنَّا مُسْلِمُونَ. Now, look, the word Rabb has been used there. That all people's book, if you say, committed shirk and the shirk was only in uluhiyyat, why is Allah saying this? That come to common terms between us and us, we will not worship except anybody except for Allah, وَلَا نُشْرِكُ بِهِ شَيْئًا, and we will not make shirk, not do shirk with Allah, وَلَا يَتَّخِذْ بَعْضُنَا بَعْضًا أَرْبَابًا مِنْ, and we will not make anybody Rabb apart from Allah, Arbab. Arbab is a plural of Rabb. If this shirk was based on uluhiyat only, why is he saying Arbab for? Meaning that their shirk is also not just shirk in uluhiyyat, is in Rabb also. That's why he's saying that we can't make anybody else Rabb apart from Allah. Ya'ani, if you believe, if you worship the idols, not only are you making another ilah apart from Allah, you're also making another Rabb apart from Allah. You are also making another Rabb apart from Allah. So the word Rabb, when the word Rabb is there, ilah has to be there. Now, So the word Rabb is very general. It consists of a lot of meanings. Amongst, like I said, complete authority, that's one of the meanings. Complete ownership, that's also part of the meaning. Right? And the other thing is legislation. What's halal and haram. This also consists in the meaning of Rabb. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the only one that has the authority to legislate what's halal, what's right, what's wrong, what's jais, what's najais. Now, the evidence to this is, if you look at Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi's narration, it's from Adi bin Hatib radiallahu ta'ala. He says, I came to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and inside my neck I had a salib min dhahab. I had a cross made out of gold. Who's saying this? Sahabi. I came to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and I had this cross made out of gold. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to me that, Ya Adi, itrah anka hadha al-wathan. وسمعت يقرا في سوره براء اتخذوا احبارا ورهبانهم اربابا من دون الله. That throw this idol away. This cross, throw it away. And then I heard him say the verse, اتخذوا احبارهم ورهبان اربابا من دون الله. That they made, you know, their leaders, their rabbis as arbab, as Rabs, apart from Allah. And he says that they did not worship them. They did not worship them, but they used to legislate as halal was halal as haram and haram as halal. So look, Allah used the word Arbab in the Quran for who? For those people that used to legislate what is right and wrong. So from this we can also tell that from the meanings of Rab is to make something halal into haram and haram into. The Jews, the Christians, the rabbis, they never worshipped Allah in that sense, but because they began to legislate, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Arbaba min dunillah. So that even they did shirk in the rububiyyat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the word rububiyyat is not just that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator, but that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has complete authority over everything, complete and general authority without any restriction in the administration of the affairs of the world. He has complete and true ownership over the creation. And he is the only one that has the right to legislate. What's right and what's wrong? Okay. So, everybody understand that so far? The word Rabb is quite generally comprehensive. Now, let's just look at one statement here from the scholars, of the Salafi scholars. We'll take Ibn Baz as an example. His definition of Tawhid al-Rububiyyah, which is all good. The definition he does is quite good, but afterwards the verdict that he gives makes a person strange, peculiar, that, you know, why is he doing that? If you look inside his ta'liqat, he's also on here too. Shaykh bin Baz, he has mentioned regarding the meaning of Tawhid al-Rububiyyah. And he says, Tawhidullah subhanahu wa ta'ala bi afa'alihi wa huwa al-Iman bi annahu al-Khaliq, al-Razik, al-Mudabbir لأمور خلقه المتصرف في شؤون خلقه بالدنيا والآخرة لا شريك له في ذلك. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what does Tawhid of Rububiyyah mean? Tawhid Rububiyyah? Tawhid Rububiyyah means, this first type of Tawhid as he says, that is to have iman that Allah is Khaliq, He is Razik, He is the Mudabbir, He controls the affairs of the dunya. He has complete authority in the matters of His creation in the dunya and akhirah. And there is no shariq with Allah, there is no partner with Allah. The definition is quite good. Ilahuna kalam jayyid. Till now the kalam is good. But then afterwards what he says is the problem. He says that this mushrikun in Makkah, mushrikeen in Makkah, the ones that worship idols, even they had iman on this. They had iman on this. Now, it's quite clear from his own definition, how did they have iman on this? In the definition he said, Al-Mudabbir li-umuri khalqihi. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He administrates the affairs of the world. In the Quranic verse it was clear, yeah, that the mushrikeen in Makkah, the administration of getting taqarrub ila Allah was delegated to the idols. So subhanallah, he said a definition which is good definition. But then afterwards when he said that even mushrikeen in Makkah believed in this, I believe, and I may Allahu alam, that he's doing this in taqleed of Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullah alayhi and other Salafi scholars. Otherwise, how can a person say such good definition and then say that even the mushrikeen in Makkah had this type of tawhid? They didn't have this type of tawhid. They created a shirk in the rububiyyat. If they had this type of tawhid, then they would have been mushrikeen in Makkah. And the other thing is that what's the first question that will be asked on the day of judgment? In the Qabr? Mar Rabbuk. Who is your Rabb? Right? Now, if mushrikeen in Makkah, their tawhid rububiyyah was valid, then according to this logic, what will happen? They will be successful and they will pass the first question. They will be able to answer the first question, but nobody says that. So clearly they were able to answer Mar Rabbuk. Why? Because they did shirk in that also in rububiyyah. Now, if let's just look at the word ilah now. This is the word Rabb. Yeah? And we clearly, you know, you can understand the many other verses that they did shirk in rububiyyat. Why? Because they attributed administration, control of administration other than Allah. Also, Allah used the word arbaba in some places where those ruhban and ahbar, the Jewish, etc., rabbi leaders, they legislated things that were halal to haram and vice versa. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the word arbab. They made apart from Allah others as Rabb. But down there they didn't worship Rabb. They didn't actually literally worship Allah. But what did they do? Because they give the quality of Rabb other than Allah. And amongst the qualities of Rabb is to legislate. That's why. Now let's look at the word ilah. Now the word ilah, linguistically, you know, if you open the books of Lughat, especially Mufradat of Imam Raghib al-Isfahani, you will get various meanings of the word ilah. One meaning of the word ilah is that at the time of needs and necessities, as a person mind where he goes towards first. Person minds where he goes towards first, instant. That is ilah. At the time of need. When a person knows that he needs help, and naturally the mind goes towards is ilah. Why? Because he is the one that only can help. He's the one that can only do something. Without any means. That's why if you look in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take an oath. وَالصَّافَاتِ صَفَّى فَالزَّاجِرَاتِ زَجَرَى فَالتَّارِيَاتِ ذِكْرَى. Allah take an oath 3 times. Allah does not need to take an oath. When He takes an oath, it's something Allah wants to emphasize on. Whereas, inna ilahakum lawahida, your ilah in all circumstances should be one. That's why Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith that even if you need shoelace, ask who? Ask Allah. When I used to Khandali Rahmatullah used to say something very, very amazing here. That we live in the time, we live in dunya. We have to acquire the means. To refuse the means that I'm only going to ask Allah, I'm not going to go to the doctors, I'm going to ask Allah and I'm not going to take physical treatment. To deny the asbab, to refuse the means, this is against the sunnah. But to have complete conviction that the means does everything, this is a type of shirk. Follow you, Surah Al-Ali, you should say this. That the job, the money, and if you look inside the Quran, subhanallah, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, what he's saying, huwa yut'imuni wa yasqin, Allah feeds me, Allah give me water to drink, wa idha maridtu fahuwa yashfin, when I'm ill, who gives me kya? Allah. We wake up in the morning, our alarm clock wakes us up, what's the dua that we read? Alhamdulillah alladhi ahyana ba'da ma amatana, all praise to Allah that has given us life after death. We come out of the toilet, we answer the call of nature, we relieve ourselves, we read Alhamdulillah alladhi adhaba an al-'adha, the all praise to Allah that has taken the difficulty situation away from me. Somebody gives us da'wah, gives us food, we eat food. What's the dua that we Alhamdulillah alladhi at'amana wa saqana. So if you look at this, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he narrated the Sahaba that every time that we something happens, it happens with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now if we look at the story of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam, his story has come in a few places, but if you look at his, the one I am particularly talking about is Surah Al-An'am. Wa Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam, falamma ra'al qamara bazighan qala hadha rabbi falamma afra qala la illam yahdi rabbi la akunanna min al-qawmi al-dhalin falamma ra'a ash-shamsa bazighatan qala hadha rabbi hadha akbar فلما أفلت قال يا قوم إني بريء مما تشركون. And similarly in Surah Al-Anbiya, if you look at the verses where Allah, where Ibrahim عليه الصلاة والسلام, he is talking to his people, and in Surah Al-In'am is actually, you know, حاجة وقوم, he starts debating with his people, and you know, when he looks at the sun and the sun, it sets and it goes, this can't be my Lord. Looks, moon disappears, this can't be my Lord. The stars disappear, this can't be my Lord. Why? Because disappearing and changing, this is a sign of creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from change. He's not subject to the vicissitudes of time. You know, we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from time. Don't we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from time? Why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala free from time? Because number one, Allah created time. Number two, when a person loses time, you see, a person loses time. Everybody loses time. And losing time is a sign of incapability. A losing time is a sign of incapability. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from such defects. So, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam, at the end, when he says, قَالَ تُحَاجُونِ فِي اللَّهِ, I don't want to go through the whole conversation because it'll take long, but at the end when he's having this debate and he's discussing حَاجَهُ قَوْمُهُ with his قَوْمُ لَتُحَاجُونَنِي فِي اللَّهِ وَقَدْ هَدَانِ وَلَا أَخَافْ مَا تُشْرِكُونَ بِهِ إِلَّا أَنْ يَشَاءَ رَبِّي شَيْئًا وَسِعَ رَبِّي كُلَّ شَيْءٍ عِلْمًا أَفَلَا تَتَذَكَّرُونَ. He said, are you arguing with me regarding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And He has guided me. Yeah? وَلَا أَخَافْ مَا تُشْرِكُونَ بِهِ إِلَّا أَنْ يَشَاءَ رَبِّي شَيْئًا. And I do not fear what you are doing shirk in or with, except my Rabb, what he, anything that he wishes. So that, and if you look at this verse very carefully, in this verse, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam first mentioned the word ilah, Allah. Because Allah is from ilah. He says, are you arguing me regarding Allah? Yeah, are you regarding me regarding Allah? So ilah is from ilah, they're both same. La ilaha illallah. There is no ilah except for Allah. So Allah is from ilah. So he's mentioned the word ilah, Allah, in the beginning. That you argue with me regarding Allah. Then at the end, what does he say? Except what my Rabb wishes. Except what my Rabb wishes. So he's mentioned the word ilah in the beginning and the Rabb at the end. And they are both referring to the same being. Who is that? Allah, he's talking about Allah, isn't he? So what does that mean? Though if wherever there's Rabb, there will be ilah. And wherever there's ilah, there will be Rabb. Because ilah has the same meaning. If a person minds, for example, that's one of the meaning. Let's take another meaning. The word ilah can be from aliyah ya'lahu, which means a person's he's left in perplexity. Yani he's dazzled by. The reason Allah is called ilah in that sense is because when a person looks at the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he ponders and contemplates inside the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will see that he'll be dazzled, subhanallah. This entire control of complete authority of the weather, of the sun and the moon, everything. Looking at this, a person will be dazzled. That this is none other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then a person can only be dazzled by this once he accepts that Allah is the one that has complete authority over all this. Allah is the one that is controlling all this. Allah is the one that has created all this. So when Allah is the one that is created all this, when Allah is the one that has control over this, then who has the right to be worshipped? Only Allah. So if you look at the word ilah, if you look at the word Rabb, they are very, very closely linked. They sort of mean the same. You probably think I'm going to be in the same thing because they are the same thing. And even in the Quran, the word ilah, Allah and Rabb, they have been used in the same context, in the same meaning. So when the mushrikeen in Makkah, when they did shirk, they didn't just do shirk in uluhiyat, in worshipping, they also did shirk in the rububiyat, as is mentioned from the Quran. Now quickly moving forward, the reason why Shaykh bin Baz and the others, their view is against the Quranic verses and ahadith are several. One is, look, if you look at Surah Al-A'raf, let's just turn to Surah Al-A'raf, verse 172. وَإِذْ أَخَذَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَنِي آدَمَ مِنْ ظُهُورِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ وَأَشْهَدُهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ قَالُوا بَلَىٰ شَهِدَنَا أَن تَقُولُوا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ إِنَّا كُنَّا نَعَذَا غَافِلِينَ. You know, when your Rabb extracted, he took from the backs of the children of Adam, you know, the descendants, and called them to witness over themselves, saying, am I not your Rabb? They replied, certainly we testify to it. This was done. Why was this done? So that when they do not say on the day of Qiyamah, indeed we were unaware of this Tawhid. So from this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him, Alastu bi Rabbik, am I not your Rabb? And what did they say? Qabala. So from this verse, we understand that giving testimony that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Rabb, this is sufficient for Iman. Rabb. Okay, from this verse, because what did Allah say? Alastu bi Rabbik, use the word Rabb. For Najat. I mean, Allah mentioned at that time afterwards, people either implement it or not. That's a different story. Yes, it comes, our Ustaz used to say in class, Mufti Musa Sahab, that some Sahaba, they said, we could actually remember when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took this up. He said this to us. The Iman was so strong, some of the Sahaba, they said that we can even remember when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this to us, Alastu bi Rabbikum. So where did Allah use the word Rabb then? So, and they agreed to that. So from this we can tell that just rububiyat, believing Allah is Rabb, is enough for najat, is enough for salvation. Otherwise Allah would use any other word. Why did Allah use deliberately Alastu bi Rabbikum, use the word Rabb? So having iman in rububiyyah and not having iman in uluhiyyah, it doesn't make sense, because the Quran is clearly saying that the word Rabb itself is enough for najat. Yes, afterwards people in their life, that's a different story, if they implement it or not, they act upon what they said at that time. Yes, a lot of people break the promises, don't they? They say one thing, afterwards they do something, and that's a different story. But at that time, Allah used the word Rabb, and they said, yes, hey Allah, we believe you as a Rabb. So from this we can understand that to believe Allah as Rabb is enough for salvation. Similarly, the first question in the grave, as I mentioned before, will be about Rabb, mar Rabbuk. And at that time, like Hadith Imam Muslim, the Quranic verse was revealed, يُثَبِّتُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِالْقَوْلِهِ ثَابِتُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will strengthen the believers with the qawl thabit, with the established statement. This is in the Hadith reported by Imam Muslim in Kitab al-Jannah وَصِفَةُ نَعِيمِهَا وَأَهْلِهَا. And this verse is in, يُثَبِّدُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِالْقَوْلِ الثَّابِتِ. Surah Ibrahim, غالباً, 13 chapter, 13 juz. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will strengthen those people, the iman people, with the قَوْلِ الثَّابِتِ. What does قَوْلِ الثَّابِتِ mean? The established statement. And is that, what's that referring to? As it comes in the narration, the Prophet said, نَزَلَ فِي عَذَابِ الْقَبْرِ. At the time of questioning in عَذَابِ الْقَبْرِ, when a person is asked the question, مَا رَبُّكْ؟ Okay. Allah says, يُثَبِّتُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِالْقَوْلِ الثَّابِتِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will strengthen the believers at that time. Okay, to be able to answer the question. So if Tawhid Rububiyyah, if they had iman to Tawhid Rububiyyah, then what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mean that Allah will strengthen the believers? Do you understand what I'm trying to derive the ruling, the evidence from here? That Allah said He would establish the believers in answering the question. Which question? Mar Rabbuk. That's the first question. Who is your Lord? So Allah's called them believers. They will only able to answer the question if they had rububiyyat. Okay? To say to Mushrikeen in Makkah had rububiyyat is against this verse too. Because Allah's calling them the people of iman. When they're able to answer the rububiyyat question, they'll be the people of iman. So if they can't answer the question, that will mean they don't have rububiyyat. That's why Mushrikeen Makkah cleared a shirk in rububiyyat, and it was not only uluhiyyat. Now, if you look at the Quran, Surah Mu'minun, مَتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ مِنْ وَلَدٍ وَمَا كَانَ مَعَهُ مِنْ إِلَهٍ إِذَا لَذَهَبَ كُلُّ إِلَٰهٍ بِمَا خَلَقَ وَلَا عَلَىٰ بَعْضُهُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ عَمَّا يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. This Quranic verse, Mu'minun, sorry, Mu'minun verse 91, also clearly demonstrates that the Rabb and Ilah both mean that they both mean the same. This is Surah Mu'minun verse 91. There's other few verses, but this is the last verse, inshallah. Surah Mu'minun verse 91. Subhanallah, this verse is that Allah has not taken any مَتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ مِنْ وَلَدٍ وَمَا كَانَ مَعَهُ مِنْ إِلَهٍ. No other any aliha with him. There's no other aliha. If there was another ilah apart from Allah, then what would happen? Allah would say, إِذَا لَذَهَبَ كُلُّ إِلَهٍ بِمَا خَلَقْ. Then every ilah would have separated his creation so that only he should have control over them. Yeah? وَلَا عَلَىٰ بَعْضُهُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضُ. And some would overpower the others. عَمَّا سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ عَمَّا يَصِفُونَ. Allah is pure of the partners that they ascribe to Him. So if you look at this verse, what did Allah say? Subhanallah. This argument inside Ilm al-Kalam, we mentioned Ilm al-Kalam last week, is called as Burhan Tamano. Burhan Tamano. The evidence of hindrance, as they say. You know, there's two evidences, logical, there's two evidences. Logically, from Ilm al-Kalam, but both established from the Quran. One, to prove the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, number one, logically. And number two, to prove the existence of Allah, to prove the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I think we'll do this after.
Okay.
Yeah, because this, we'll do this after. Okay, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Moving on forward quickly, let's try to speed these things up. In the previous session, we discussed regarding the types of Tawhīd, Rububiyyah, Uluhiyyah, and Asma wa Sifat. And we mentioned that Rububiyyah and Uluhiyyah are very closely linked. They're almost the same meaning, because Rububiyyah has a very general meaning. It consists the meaning of the Allah's complete ownership, that He has complete authority over the administration of the affairs that take place inside His creation. It also has a meaning of legislating, like we observe from the Quranic verse, where arbab min dunillah, where they made the ahbar and the ruhbar, arbab. What is the arbab mean down there? Not that they worship, but because they regarded them to be legislators. That's why Allah used the word rab for them. So the word rab is a very broad meaning. And the mushrikeen in Makkah didn't just do shirk inside the uluhiyyah, but they also did shirk inside rububiyyah. And I briefly mentioned some of the evidences which Sheikh bin Baz and others go against by making this sort of ruling regarding the types of Tawheed. The first, وَإِذْ أَخَذَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَنِي آدَمٍ مِنْ ذُورِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّةٌ وَأَشْنُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِمْ أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ قَالُوا بَلَىٰ شَهِدْنَا. Allah asked the people there that, am I not your Rabb? So from this word, he having iman on Rabb is enough for najat, is enough for salvation. Before I move on to logical evidences, we're still on the first point. Inna Allah Ta'ala wahid la sharika la. I'm going to mention two logical evidences for this first text. But before I move on to that, I'm going to mention one last evidence, even though there's so many more, where ilah and rab have been used in the same context in the Quran. And in the last session, I was mentioning that verse before the salah time, verse 91, Surah Al-Mu'minun, where Allah says, مَتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ مِنْ وَلَدٍ وَمَا كَانَ مَعْهُ مِنْ إِلَهِ. That Allah has not made anybody into His son, right? And there's no other ilah with Him. He's the only ilah. إِذَا لَذَهَبَ كُلُّ إِلَهٍ بِمَا خَلَقَ. If there was another ilah, apart from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then every ilah would have taken, their creation. Whatever they created, they would have taken it, and some would overpower the others. Now, why do I say that the word ilah here has been used as Rabb? Because what is Rabb? What's one of the meanings of Rabb? One of the meanings of Rabb is to have complete control, have complete authority, control, the way they administer the affairs of the creation. So what does this word mean here? That if there was another ilah apart from Allah, every creation would have taken their part. And they would start controlling their own kingdom, if you want to say. Alright? And wala ala ba'd ba'd, they would have overpowered one another, meaning they would, every single one of them would have, shown their own power, shown their own sovereignty, the complete ownership of the creation. So that is the meaning of Rabb. But down here, the meaning that we can obviously extract and infer from this verse is the meaning of Rabb. That's what Rabb is. Rabb has complete ownership. There's also in the word Rabb, the word Malik is also in there. Milkiyat, complete. Milkiyat and ownership. That's the meanings we can infer from this verse. But what word has been used? Ilah. Allah, He said, وَمَا كَانَ مَعَهُ مِنْ إِلَهِ. There is no ilah with Allah. And if there was ilah with Allah, then this would have happened. That every ilah would have taken their own creation and they've started doing their own ruler, having their own sovereignty and own kingdom to themselves. So the context is the meanings of Rabb, but the word is being used here, ilah. Does everybody understand? So what does that mean? But the word ilah means Rabb, and the word Rabb means they're both laziman, they're both laziman and malzum, they're intrinsic. Okay? So that was just one more evidence that I wanted to mention.